Yeah, thank you for the nice introduction. This is basically an introduction talk to Docker and also to testing and shipping Python applications with Docker. So you are right here if you may be a newbie to Docker or haven't used it only moderately, but maybe you won't learn anything if you are a very experienced Docker user already. But this doesn't mean that you have to go. You can sit through my talk and watch the most advanced Docker talk after mine as well. But beware, this is a disclaimer, this is an introductory talk. Yeah, so the examples I will show are, of course, not a real application. They are basically slideware Python Hello World applications, which will be shipped and tested with Docker, so please don't expect any real big applications here as well. And also, although this is an introduction due to time, I will have to leave out some features of Docker as well, and a 40-minute introduction talk cannot be a substitute for a full course or a book on Docker as well. Yeah, if you have questions, I think we have time at the end. Yeah. A few quick words about mine. I was already introduced. I'm a technical lead for data science at Rosen. I was before a theoretical physicist. Here are some contact details if you want to reach me and discuss about anything like Docker or Python or other programming languages. And yeah. A few quick words about the company. So Rosen is a service provider for the energy industry and does asset care. We're doing a lot of machine learning, but I will keep it short. We are a sponsor. If you're interested in what we are doing, please come outside and visit our booth. So no much talk about the company. We are working in predictive and preventive maintenance. So what is my motivation for giving this talk, basically? So there are, as you can see in the picture already, a lot of solutions for dependency management and deployment of Python. You know them already, like pip or conda from Anaconda, and you can freely choose any of them, and they are all good, basically. And yeah, I personally like Anaconda a lot, and of course, like in the picture, you can also easily mess up your local environment if you have a lot of them installed at the same time and you don't know what you are doing. And Docker is basically not a replacement for a package manager like pip or Anaconda. It's nearly, yeah, help if you want to do something else or achieve something else. Maybe you need a point where you need Docker is, for example, if you have a complex application which you want to run or ship, maybe not only on your system, but on other people's computers, and you include not only Python packages, but for example, some other strange libraries you dearly need, or big binary blobs of other stuff, which is not so easily achievable with the standard solutions for package management. Yeah, and what we usually also do is, because Docker is not a replacement for package managing, we run like pip or conda within Docker. So Docker is not meant as a replacement. I'm repeating myself here, but this is a gist also of my talk. So another motivation for Docker, I really like this meme a lot, because usually in software development, we have this works on my machine anti-pattern. This happens a lot. It can happen as well with Python. And a usual answer is put it in a Docker container and it will work on any machine. This is basically true because Docker can feel like you're shipping your machine to another computer or having several local copies of your machine available with strangely different configurations. But Docker is also not meant to be an excuse for a messy environment. Everybody knows that it's really easy to quickly mess up your local environment on your local machine. And then you can say, okay, if I do it in a container, I can keep it messy and it won't hurt my development setup, but we should work in a clean way. So don't use Docker as an excuse to work messy. And although Docker feels like shipping your machine, there are subtle differences between Docker and a virtual machine or your bare metal machine. And these differences are really important to understand and to keep in mind. But in fact, the huge advantage of Docker is reproducibility of your environment. You can easily write down a recipe to build a piece of software and have it run anywhere, but do it cleanly. Yeah, so this picture, everybody who has already worked with Docker or had a look in the documentation for Docker already knows this picture. I took it straight from the documentation of Docker. It's like an explanation what is the difference between a virtual machine and containers. And I like this picture a lot, and it's easy to understand. So in both cases, you have at the bottom some infrastructure, maybe your local laptop you want to run something on. You have an operating system which runs on your local hardware, and then the difference starts. In a virtual machine, you have an hypervisor which runs a full complete guest OS, like a new Linux with a different kernel, a BSD, a Windows, whatever have you. And on that you have your applications and libraries which you run. Docker works a little bit else. You don't have an hypervisor, you have a Docker daemon or a Docker engine, and basically your applications run on the same Linux kernel or Windows kernel, which is on your host system, and they are only isolated from each other by some other mechanisms. So there is no complete guest OS. And both approaches have, of course, their pros and cons. Maybe you need a complete different OS than you have on your local machine for your application, then you might need virtual machines. But if you only want isolation, maybe Docker is your friend, because running a complete guest OS has performance implications. Yeah. And of course, maybe you need also virtual machines for security reasons, because you can escape containers, basically. There are some exploits known, or there were some exploits before. Yeah. And both systems can, of course, be automated. Creation of containers is automated by Docker and some alternatives. Creations of VMs is automated by products from VMware or from HashiCorp like Terraform and Vagrant. So you are free to choose what fits your purpose. In this talk, we will talk about containers, but this doesn't mean that containers are inherently better than VMs in any case. They have both their own pros and cons. So how does Docker work? So on the top of the slide is a famous quote I really like. It's from Jesse Frizzell. It's, containers are not a first-class citizen of the Linux kernel. I added the second part, they are a combination of namespaces and C groups. This means that containers are not something which is built inside of Linux, which you can just call and say, I'm here on my Linux machine, on my freshly installed Ubuntu, and I just say, please create a container for me and run some kind of software. Containers are basically a concept introduced by third-party software like Docker, which relies on functions in the kernel like cgroups and namespaces. Cgroups are there for resource isolation. So in containers, you maybe want to run a software and want to constrain its resources. Maybe my application should only get, I don't know, one CPU, maybe only one CPU and 256 megabytes of RAM, for example, and the other one should get 3 CPUs and 1 gigabyte of RAM. This you can achieve with cgroups. This also implies to I/O limits or networking limits. And the other part, namespaces, is basically the isolation part. So you want to have these processes see different kind of resources from each other and from basically also separated from your host system. So for example, you want to say that you want to have a different process tree for all your containers. So usually in Linux, you have one process tree and everything is a child of init or systemd, for example. But in containers, you want to isolate that as well, so that inside the container, you don't know that you are part of your host system. And there are namespaces for different things. So there's a mount namespace. This means that you can have different file systems in your containers and that they don't know the file system of a different container or the host. Process tree, which I talked about. They can have their own network devices. They can have their own host and domain names and their own user IDs. The only thing I sometimes miss as a downside, there is no namespace for time. So you cannot isolate time, for example. Could be important, could be unimportant to you. I don't know. So I said containers are basically coming from third-party software. So what software we can use to create containers. So this talk is about Docker, so I will be talking about Docker, but I will also, of course, mention some alternatives. Docker is like Python. In my experience, the batteries included solution. You get a good CLI, which helps you, and there's a lot of pre-built stuff available for it. So if you just want to start, this is a good starting point. But the downside of Docker, at least in my experience, is it comes with a daemon, which needs to be root, which can be a bad thing, for example, in a corporate environment. at least my experience. So if you go to IT and say, I want to install some software which runs a daemon, which is root, they are sometimes a little bit skeptical, because being a Docker user gives you implicitly administrator privileges, at least implicitly. There are alternatives like Podman, which is gaining some steam at the moment, which is basically a one-to-one replacement for Docker, but doesn't need to be root, which is also good. In the last years, there were other famous projects like Rocket, RKT, but this has been archived by the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, I think 1 or 2 months ago, so it's basically a dead project, so you don't have to look it up again. And there is LXC, Linux Containers, which gives you good APIs for creating containers from programming language like Go or Python or Ruby. And of course, as I mentioned in the beginning, you can do the same for VMs. I mentioned already Vagrant, for example, for automating VMs if you want to do that. There are also some projects which are like on the boundary of VMs and containers. I don't know if you know Firecracker from Amazon, which is basically the idea to have micro VMs which are as fast as containers but more secure. And Qatar goes into the same direction. But again, we were talking about Docker here. But just to keep in mind that there are alternatives which might fit your purpose better. I don't know, I cannot decide for you what you want to use. So let's start with the basic terminology of Docker. In Docker, there, at least for me, there are three important vocabularies. There's the Docker file, the Docker image, and the Docker container, and often these vocabulary gets mixed up somehow. So what is a Docker file? The Docker file is a description, or as I would put it, the build recipe for what you want to build. You put into it the description of libraries and software you want to have in your container at the end and give it to Docker to build from that an image. And an image is basically layers on disk, or you could say the executable stored on your file system. And if you run an image, it becomes a container, which is then like the running process or the running application. And as I said, this vocabulary is often interchangeably used, so a lot of people don't know when to say container and image. It happens to me as well. But keep in mind, an image is like the binary on disk, and the container is like the running instance. How does it look if we make the picture a little bit bigger? So in the end, we have not only the images and the container, there's also stuff around it. We have the registry, which is like a repository for pre-built images. So there's an official one, Docker Hub, where you can get all the stuff you need, like Docker as batteries included, so you find Python on there, or databases, or web servers, or whatever have you. You can put your stuff on there if it's open source, or you want to share it with the world. But you can also host your own registry on-premise in your corporation, or your home if you want, for your own stuff, which, for example, we do in our company. And what Docker basically does, if you tell it that you need an image for something, via Docker pull, it will look in the registries you have provided for in the configuration. Maybe it's your company one or the official one, downloads this image to disk. And if you do Docker run or Docker container run, it will run the image. It becomes a container. And then your application runs and does what it is intended to do, or you can interact with it. And this is basically all the basic vocabulary. And this is all managed by the Docker daemon, running as root on your system, which is controlled by the CLI, which talks to the daemon, or it has also a REST API, which you can talk to. Or for some program languages, there are also software development kits for interacting with the Docker daemon, which we will see here. There's a Python SDK, which I will be using for testing. Yeah. There are Docker images for Python, of course. You could build your own if you wanted to. You could start from scratch with an image for a bare Linux distribution and install Python on that, but you don't need to. There's an official Python image in every version which you can think of, 2.x, 3.x, whatever you need. Also, Continuum.io provides images for Anaconda and Miniconda, which you can use, so you don't have to build it yourself. And what you should basically do, or what I basically do, is I start either from Python or from Miniconda, install all the stuff I need, and then I'm ready to do what I want. So how would you build your own image? And then this is the part I'm a little bit scared about, because it involves a demo. So let's see how that works. I tested it last night, so it should work, but let's see. So here is a screenshot of how a Docker file would look like. So in the beginning, I said a Docker file is a description of the build recipe. So now we need to know what do we put in there. We usually start with a from statement, and the from statement says, okay, we want to start from a container and put additional stuff in it, or modify from an image, and we want to put additional stuff in it or modify it in some way. And this is achieved with the from statement here. And here I say I want to start from a Python container. The colon notation says you can attach a tag to the image name, and usually the tag is used for version numbers, for example. So here I say I want to start from Python version 3.7, so the official container. And now what do I want to do with it? So maybe I have a script I want to put in it. The next statement is a run statement, and with run I can execute shell commands during build time in the image. So here I run mkdir and I create a directory called source where I want to put my Python script in. With the next step with copy, I copy myscript.py, which is on my file system next to my Docker file. I can copy it inside of the image during the build in the source directory. So I have it available in my image and can run it later there. Now with workdir, I can change the directory during build time to the source directory because I want to start the script from there afterwards. With run, I can execute another shell command, and here I use pip to install numpy, for example, because maybe I need it in my script. And in the end, it's like the most important command. It's the command. It tells during the build process the image what should be executed when we run the image as a container afterwards. So when I start the image as a container, I want to run Python myscript.py. This is achieved via the command. Looks like this is a little bit strange syntax. You can write it a little bit else as well, but it's basically you put into the square brackets the commands and as strings and separated by a comma where white spaces would be. And this we can do also live, and I will now see if it works or not. Is it somehow readable? Okay, nice. That's good, because I don't see. So here I have a Docker file, which I just mentioned. It's basically the same. It starts from Python 3.7. I copy in a requirements.txt where I have all my files in. I run pip install on the requirements.txt. I copy in a main.py, which is my main Python script. I use another command expose, which is like a documentation command. It tells for documentation purposes that I want to export port 80 from my container to the host system afterwards. And in the end, my command is running a web server, which is execute some commands which are specified in main.py, which is a basic REST API, which we can look at here. So it's a very, very small script. It uses fast API to create a very fake REST API, which just returns something you put in again, unmodified. And the requirements.txt would only be fast API. And now we can build it if we want. So to build a Docker file, I use docker build minus t, and then the name I want to give to the image. It could be my RP, for example. And then I say dot, and dot specifies the local folder because docker build wants to know where the Docker file is. It's not so good. Yeah, I'm in the wrong directory. And now it runs the build. It's usually not that fast, but I've done everything before because I don't trust conference Wi-Fi. So it's basically using everything from cache, which is already there. Usually it would start downloading Python 3.7, And pip would also take a little while, but it's already there and cached, so it's pretty much fast. And now I can run the application if I want. This would be Docker container run. I say dash dash rm to delete the container when it's finished. Minus d to run it in the background. Minus p to define port forwarding. So I want port 80 on the host mapped to port 80 in the container so that I can curl my API. I give the container a name. Blah is maybe a good name, very descriptive. And then I run my RP. So this works. You see this cryptic hash, which is basically the ID, which you can use later, or you can use the name in most commands. So therefore, I defined a name. If you don't define a name, it gets chosen randomly from a list of adjectives and names of scientists, which is also pretty funny. And now I can curl it. Localhost 80. And now if I curl it, I get my response back, so it basically works. And now I don't need it anymore, so I say docker container. Docker container stop, and I called it blah, and now it's gone. So pretty easy. And this part of the demo is finished. Yeah, but what would you do if you would like to run multiple containers at the same time? So like in this very fakey slideware example, you have a REST API which just returns an int you give in. This is normally not your real application. Usually you get your data somewhere, maybe from a database, or you would store some information somewhere. And maybe you have like a second application which provides data to your first application, or you want to run a database in a container or a Redis cache where you want to cache some values. You can also do that in a container. And of course, you could manage multiple containers just via the CLI. You could say Docker container run the first thing, and then the second thing, and the third thing, and the fourth thing. But this gets tedious relatively fast. And also, it gets a little tiresome because you have to remember names and define networks so that containers can talk to each other. But Docker can luckily automate everything for you using a tool from Docker, which is called Docker Compose. And Compose just does this under the hood, what I just told you. So it usually, you define another build recipe, but not for one container, but for a multi-container application. And it runs that, it sets up the networks correctly so that the applications can talk to each other, and does some other funny things which I will show you. And this is basically then run on your local machine. So this is not an orchestrator. So if you want to have it run on different machines at the same time or on a cluster, you would need something like Kubernetes or Docker Swarm. Docker Compose only runs it on your local machine, and I don't think I have time to talk about orchestrators because this is like one or two talks on its own. Here we are back. So we'll be looking at Docker Compose now. And Docker Compose has its own format for a build recipe. It's called a Docker Compose YAML, so it's a YAML file. Hooray, we all love YAML. Or I don't, at least. And what you define there is basically what containers do you want to run and what is their configuration. You start with a version, so this is a version of the Docker Compose API you want to use. Then there come the services. These are basically the containers you want to run. You give them names. The first one is called web. This is my API. I specify a build command. This means in the folder API, there is a Docker file, and this should be built and run as a web container. I want to map port 80 to port 80 so that I can curl it again from my local host. But this time I also need another image. This is Redis. I want to run a Redis container. This is a pre-built image I want to get from Docker Hub. So I use Redis colon alpine. Here the tag is used to specify the distribution on which the Redis was built. So it's Alpine Linux here. And now I can just call Docker Compose up and it will be run. Already. Ooh, I'm talking slowly, sorry. And yeah, maybe I skip this part because it takes a little bit longer. So, to come to the second part of my talk, which is cut short, I think, testing with Docker. So, of course, you have a lot of code in your containers. You want to test it somehow. And of course, you can run unit tests inside of the same container or different containers when you build your application. But what is with the rest of the stuff? So if a Docker file, you have configurations, you have basically some bash scripts, which are run as a command of the container, and you have maybe several containers you put together. So this is all in need of some kind of integration or end-to-end testing, maybe. So how would you do that? Of course, you could maybe write a real big bash script which tests out every combination you can think of, and this is also a viable solution, but maybe there are other solutions, and maybe also solutions in Python you can use. So maybe we start with a solution which is just using bash. I don't know if you know it, but bash has also a unit or a testing framework called BATS, and this is relatively easy to set up to test your stuff, because yeah, you're already using the Docker CLI to start containers. And then if you use like a testing framework from bash, it's pretty easy because you have setup code, which is just maybe building and running your container. Then you have your test, which, for example, could run curl against an endpoint. And then you test, is the exit code okay? And then your test has executed correctly and all the tests are green and you are happy. But this is a little bit tedious because now you have, if you want to like test the output of your JSONs, you have to escape all the quotes and stuff like that. And also the project is not so actively maintained. I looked it up. I think the last commit is from 2018. So maybe you want to use it, maybe not. But there's a better way, or there are two better ways I like real much. So there's a Docker SDK for Python. So instead of using the CLI, you can talk to the Docker daemon from Python. You can achieve this by pip install Docker, then you have the SDK, you can import Docker, and then you can basically start and run containers, build images, stop them, kill them, do whatever you want. And usually you can use this in testing to write test fixtures. So I will not execute it, I will just show it for time reasons. So if you have this installed, you can just call import Docker, and then you can, for example, in PyTest write a fixture. You just say, okay, I need to talk to my Docker daemon. This is done via this initialization command here. Then you can say, okay, I want to build an image where the Docker file is in the local directory, call it myrp. Oh, it's not good. Sorry. Then you can run the container also via a command in Python, define the port mapping and some additional configuration. And then in a, like in a typical test fixture in PyTest, you yield. Then you go to your test where you, via requests, maybe talk to your API. If this has worked out, then you go back here and you call something I call teardown container. What you basically do is stop and remove the containers and you are done. No, it's not. Yeah, you could replicate what Docker Compose is doing with that, but it's doesn't come with built-in Compose functionality. So you can, there's no, like, the Docker SDK doesn't have something where you can just import the YAML and run everything at once. So you, here would you have to do it by hand in Python code, which you can do, but it could also be tedious if you have a lot of containers which you want to plug together. Yeah. Then what you mean, there is basically an alternative to that, which you can also use.
So I just asked if you can use Docker Compose together with that one.
Yeah. Well, you cannot use it directly together with that one. You would have to replicate what it's in the, what's in the YAML file. But if you want to use a Docker Compose YAML, there is a plugin for PyTest called PyTest Docker Compose, which automatically generates PyTest fixtures, based on what you've written in your Docker Compose YAML and takes care of Docker Compose up and down for you. And this is, I think, basically what you want. And I would prefer that if you want to test more than one or two containers at the same time and you already have a Docker Compose YAML. And this is also an actively maintained project, which is also good. And you don't have to write the fixtures yourself, which is also good. Yeah. And then there's also a third project which you can use. It's called Seaworthy. It also tries to automatically generate test fixtures for you, or you need to help it a little bit to generate test fixtures for PyTest. It defines classes for your containers, and inside you define like patterns, like when is the container finally started, what kind of errors you expect, and then you write the tests. But for your containers, you have to write your own classes, and there are only some pre-built classes available, like for Postgres, SQL, or Django. So maybe if you use these two, this is an easy startup for what everybody else needs to write their own classes, and it has no Compose support and is still alpha level software. So what I personally do at work, I use either the Docker Compose PyTest plugin, or for small things, I write my own fixtures with the Docker SDK and PyTest. And
Is there something similar to the Docker Compose testing using the PyTest plugin for Kubernetes or Docker Swarm?
So for Kubernetes, I cannot know because we're currently not using Kubernetes. For Docker Swarm, I'm not aware. What we usually do is we replicate what we want to deploy on a Swarm on our local machine using Compose and test it there, and afterwards deploy it to Swarm. But maybe there is something around I'm just not aware of. Could be, I don't know. So and let's come to my final slide. So what are use cases for Docker and Python? Basically, you can deploy a lot of stuff like REST APIs, for example, web applications. You can also have an advantage with Docker if you want to deploy something which has dependencies like databases or other stuff, which you can also put in a container. You can distribute scientific workloads, which might require some strange library put into it, which you don't want to have installed on your local system. You can also put like training of machine learning models in there. This is also something we have done. You can do continuous integration with Docker. So even if you don't want to use Docker to deploy your application, you can have like use Docker to perform your testing. And what basically, at least for me, is a main advantage of Docker is a reproducible environment across different machines. If you have an image build, it is the same image on all the machines you can run it on. And this is really nice. And there are, I think, two things which you should not do with Docker, which are for me like pretty clear stuff, but some people confuse it anyway. So don't use Docker for security reasons, because the isolation is not so good like with other stuff you can get. So there are, for good reasons, there are VMs and sandboxes and jails. So if you want to isolate applications for security reasons, Docker might not be the best choice for you. And again, don't use Docker as an excuse for a messy environment. Because like you say, okay, my build process is complicated and messy and I don't like it, so I put it into a container. This is also not like a good idea. Yeah, this would be basically the end. I don't know if I have still a minute left.
Yeah.
Then, just let me show here, there are some resources. So I said the talk cannot be a replacement for a full course on Docker. So there's a Udemy course, Docker Mastery from Brett Fisher, a Docker captain. And I really, really like that course. And I can recommend it if you want to learn more about Docker. There's also Docker Labs with a lot of more sophisticated examples. There's a documentation on the Docker SDK. There's a GitHub for the Bash unit testing system BATS. And I also included the documentation for Seaworthy and PyTest Docker Compose. And I think that's it.
Yeah, thank you very much. So So if anybody has questions, I think it's the right time to ask.
Thank you. So I'm not a Docker expert, like probably on the other side of the spectrum, but I remember when I had to set it up on Windows, I had to disable some stuff that I never even heard of, like Hyper-V, I think it was called. So the question is that if I do something on Docker, package it up, and send it to somebody, do I have to expect that person to install Docker on their machine, or is there a way to run it without having to go through all the installation steps?
So basically, if you want to distribute a Docker image, the other user who needs to use it does need to have Docker installed in some way. It can be painful on Windows, especially in corporate environments like, I don't know, very crazy virus scanners or isolation environments can hurt you there. And there's a subtle difference between Docker on Windows and Docker for Windows as well. So it can be difficult, but yeah, basically, basic answer is the other person needs to have Docker installed.
So thank you for the talk. I have a question about the size of the image. Yeah. So I also tried it a bit. I'm really not an expert, but what I tried to use Python 3.7, then I tried to use the Slim and then the Alpine. And when I tried to install a requirement, then crashed on the Alpine because I was missing some C thing, I expect, nothing like that. Do you have any kind of advice on that? Because Alpine is what will make the image lower, like the smallest, and so it's better for deployment. But then if we have to debug it ourselves, that's terrible. So
yeah, so my experience with Alpine Linux are also mixed. And what you experience is basically, yeah, Alpine is small, and this is correct, but Alpine uses a different libc than most other Linux distributions, and this can hurt really a lot. Even if you try pip install something and it isn't built against the libc which is used on Alpine, then you maybe experience something like you have. Yeah. And my usual way is I try something like you as well. I start with normal, as a normal like Miniconda or Python 3. Something, and then I see, does it work very well with Slim? Does it work with Alpine again? But in the end, at least in the environment I work in, it doesn't hurt if an image is like 500 megabytes of size or something like that.
So this is my first ever introduction to Docker, and I would be interested to hear more about what sort of things you can isolate. So you were saying, for example, you cannot isolate time. What kind of things would you like to put in the containers and isolate to share with your colleagues and with other machines?
So what we usually do with Docker and what we try to do with it is, like, for example, there are different stuff like, so one thing could be like this fakey example I showed. I have like a web server I want to run, and I have like a big machine where I run, I don't know, 100 of these on. Another example, like I said on my last slide, you have like scientific workloads, like simulations or training machine learning models, and you want to distribute it like on a cluster or something. Then it's easy to put that into a container, because you want to deploy it to some other computer or to a cluster, and you don't have to install all the dependent libraries there. Take the example of an FEM simulation. It might need some kind of open source library, which is hard to compile and stuff like that. So you do it one time for the image, and then you can distribute your calculations freely. You only have to, for example, change the configuration of what you want to calculate.
Can you just quickly elaborate on how to, on a good way to set up your own registry on premises, which you mentioned earlier?
I think there is a GitHub repo you can fork with a good description on it. So I didn't do it myself in the company. It was our IT department which did it, but I think they didn't experience much problems. So at the moment, we are running two registries in our company, one like for permanent deployment of images and one for continuous integration, where like if you build an image and just for testing purposes, you push it there, and this is then automatically deleted after the continuous integration job has finished or after 24 hours. And from what I was told, this was pretty easy to set up.
Thanks.
I think you can Google it pretty easily.
So my level was quite on par with the introduction, and that's about it. Now I learned today that I can also use Python to deploy an image and or in the end and container. Except for testing using PyTest, is there another application or use case where you would use rather Python to set up, let's say, in backend API, whatever? Because so far I only would have used Docker without Python to set it up, but maybe you can elaborate on that. So when to use Python for the deployment when it's not only about testing.
So it depends. Maybe you have an environment where you like, for example, it's hard to say. I mainly use it for testing. I know that, for example, Docker Compose is written in Python using this SDK. And maybe if you want something like Docker Compose, but slightly different for your special use case, you could use it. Or if you have some other thing, maybe you don't want to write Docker files, but or you want to write Docker files using Python and then automatically build them with the SDK and run them. But yeah, it's for me, it's mainly testing, but I think there are other use cases as well.
Are there, from your experience, any caveats from running databases in a container?
Well, there are some caveats, so you have to, like, most people don't run their databases in containers. I did use it here for the example application. I think it's still a discussion in the community if it makes sense to run a database in a container or not, since there are sometimes performance issues and also other stuff. You need to create volumes to store your data and stuff like that, and it's not so easy to, for example, deploy a database on a swarm where you don't have control where the volume is stored, for example, if you have different machines. But it's still an open discussion, and I'm not very opinionated in that.
You mentioned about security concern with Docker. Can you please explain a little bit more detail?
For example, there was, I don't know, I think 1 or 2 years ago, a very famous exploit, Dirty Cow, where you could escape a container and become root on the host system, for example. This would be, for example, a security concern, though. And if you can escape from a container to the host then and become root there or somehow privileged there, then you own the system. And this is something which you should want to prevent, basically. And Docker is not built with security as its highest target, basically. So they are taking care of security, of course, but it's not like Docker was not built for a security purpose. Therefore, there are other things. And therefore, sometimes
you can start your Docker container as non-root, or you can start the Docker container as unprivileged mode, right?
Yeah.
To work around that.
I think so. The Docker daemon can become unprivileged. I think this was in the last release somewhere, and there are alternatives like Podman, which are completely unprivileged, and then we have less of these problems, basically.
All right. I think this is it. Thank you very much for your questions, and thank you very much for an amazing introduction. It was super interesting. Let's give an applause to our speakers.